People, KT here for AMD Garage. Today we're going on another shop tour. We're gonna go see some good friends of mine, Susie and Rodney from Suspension Geek, and they've got a lot of stuff going on. It's one of the things I love so much about Middle Tennessee is that there's so many shops in such a tight confined area with really interesting stuff happening. We're gonna go and look at a truck that's going to end up out of the SEMA show in 2024, and it's very rare that we get to see the underpinnings and the first layers of a custom build. And also, we get to see kind of the thought process behind it. Listen, it's not just a shop building a vehicle, it's a team. It's a team of people that are like-minded, have common goals, and are just doing this for the right reasons. So we got a little bit of windshield time to go. I can't wait for you to see this one. It's going to be cool. Suspension Geek. I can't wait for you guys to see inside. No more messing around. Let's go. Okay, so the eye candy is outstanding.
Who's that?
Rodney is hiding behind Kevin. A Camaro over here.
Oh, hold on. I'm just checking the starter on this one. So, making sure we get it to turn over.
I'm making sure my camera shoots what I'm pointing it at.
Oh.
All right, so the LSs are, they're everywhere. All right, so what you're seeing, this is a 69 Camaro, obviously, we know what that is, but all the goodies, and we're gonna talk to Rodney about it, and we're gonna talk to Susie also, but there's some great stuff happening here. There's another 69 Camaro. Oh, look at that. It's a 67.8 Camaro, 67?
60, that's a 68, yep, that one's mine. We just had this one at the big show at SEMA for a company. It's my 68 Camaro, War Machine, that's what we call her. It's a 6-liter LS. We put a lot of Summit Racing's Pro LS stuff in it, nice gear. We did custom fender flares on it, as you see. We did the whole idea behind this one was the, Zora Dantoff, when he did the 67 or 66 Corvette race program, the Grand Sport program.
Yeah.
You know, that discontinued in 67 because they went to the new body style on Corvette. So I thought to myself, what if GM had given him the okay and said, hey, you know, let's apply it to the next platform because they are racing these SCCA just like they were the Corvettes. So my idea was, what would Duntop have done? So he would have done this. He would have had flares on it. Uh-huh. He would have had his Grand Sport badge. He would have had his vents. He would have had his fender vents. He would have had his side pipes, because that's very much what Duntop would have done to make the car as light as possible. And we did the same thing. We did carbon fiber panels front and back. It's got a carbon fiber hood. So we did a roof vent. The roof vent's real.
How cool is that? That's so vintage race car-y, I can't stand it.
It's real. If you look inside, you can see it's got a directional ducts and vents just like in an airplane. So you can actually direct the air right to your face.
Uh-huh. You get HBO with that too?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm getting ahead of myself.
Yeah, sorry. This one's Susie's car.
All right.
So, hey!
So, you and I go back a hot minute. We started working together inadvertently when I was back on Power Block, right?
Yeah, so it's been 15 years or so
that
I met you.
Tell my good friends that are watching, who are you?
I'm the most famous nobody.
This is Rodney Prouty, founder of Suspension Geek. Hi, and yeah, history with Ride Tech, with
John Hotchkiss. I was a race car driver for John Hotchkiss. I was a driver for Ride Tech, and I did their show program for a few years. And then I worked with another gentleman up in Franklin, Tennessee, named Kent Waits, and we did the whole Optima series for about 3 years there. And then he left there to go to do Trans Am, and I left there to do my own stuff.
Yeah, as we do sometimes, we leave to do our own stuff. You know, and you and I are wired the same way. We're driven to find our own muse, and that's one of the things I really respect about you guys. And we'll talk to Susie a little bit later on.
I know this cut will never make it, so it's okay, because like we talked about before, I did a couple episodes of Gas Monkey and a couple episodes of another show, Highway to Sell, and none of them ever made it to TV. So just so you guys know.
Well, also, this is YouTube. It's not TV.
Oh, yeah.
And I've said before, and I say it again, I've had way more fun doing YouTube than I ever had doing TV. So I want to get back on the cars, so we're going to flip this camera around. So how long did it take you to do this outstanding piece of machinery? I know you were on some, I was watching you on the socials, and you whipped this thing up relatively fast.
Less than 30 days.
Less than 30 days.
Yeah, so I had 5 days. I had most of the parts here in the shop already.
Don't
look at the spoiler. We bent it.
That's because you drive it.
But it was. We were under the gun. A company we had talked to needed a car for SEMA. I had most of these parts. I actually had all the parts by then.
Cool.
Isn't that cool? Yeah, the old Radot style. It was trying to keep with the same theme of the car.
Who does your paint work?
We actually do it here. John Lindstrom used to be the owner of a company in California called Best of Show, and he does our paint. He's actually retiring. I think his last car is actually sitting in the booth over there.
Yeah. Very cool. What wheel and tire size? Are you square?
Square, 18 by 11 with 18 by 11 and a half with 315s on it.
Why 315 and not 335?
Because you can't find enough 335s in a high grip compound.
Gotcha.
And that's, you know, that's, I don't have an unlimited budget.
Yeah, no, tires, it's a real thing, right?
It's a crazy, I don't know what you call, what is it? It's a usable item, it's a disposable. You know, you put it on.
Consumable, yeah.
Yeah, it's like
sure,
a brake pad. So you put them on. You know, we've been at events where the surface is so bad that we've gone through a set of tires in a weekend. So when you put a $400 tire on and you get 3 days of racing out of it, you just, it's kind of tough sometimes.
Well, it does. And, you know, I mean, the type of racing that we're doing, you're paying for everything.
Yeah.
You know, we're blessed to have some sponsors here and there, but for the most part, you guys are promoting Suspension Geek, right?
Yeah. Yep.
What's the significance of Aces?
Oh, that was the company we had it in the booth at SEMA. They do all the fuel injection. They're a new company. Susie's car is sponsored by Holley, and they were nice enough to come on board and sponsor this car. So they did. They do a nice fuel injection system, their intakes, the throttle bodies, they do the coils, they do wires, and this one's really neat because it's got a 4L60, and their controller actually even controls the transmission, so it does ignition, fuel injection, and the transmission. And then you can see it's got everybody's, you know, there's nothing crazy complicated about the car. We did Ride-Tech's off-the-shelf parts, we have custom steering arms in there, we got rid of the radiator support and laid the radiator down. The motor is actually sitting in its stock location.
Yeah.
So nothing was really pushed far back.
Yeah. I like your bracing here also.
That's from John Hotchkiss. Yep. And then we custom built the upper part to cross over.
So I'm seeing a theme here. You've got a lot of symmetry in your design. That's not an accident, is it?
No. It's got a cooler on this side for oil and steering. It's got a transmission cooler on this side, so they're both feeding. And then as you see, you can look. The radiator hose goes one direction. The air cooler goes the other direction.
Yep.
Nope, I try to keep it, and it's all open, so it's easy to work on.
Yep, very cool.
Not like a Miata, where you have no room at all.
He's making fun of me in my Miata. Talk about the car right behind you.
Oh, Ugly Betty.
Ugly Betty.
Yeah, you can probably see her better from the other side. This is a friend of ours' car, and we've had it for many years, and it's not really a car that's being built here.
Yeah. Excuse me, let me walk around the enormous pile of AMD stuff. Wow, look at that. It's a tower of AMD.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not tall, but
We'll talk about this in a sec and the amazing vehicle that's going on, but let's talk about Ugly Betty. So the half the vinyl top.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, yeah, and this is why
vinyl
tops are no longer in vogue.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It was a great idea that was became a terrible idea. Yeah, it's a cool old school paint scheme. So what's up with this car? Give me the 30,000 foot view.
Friend of ours had built it with his dad many years ago, and then it sat in storage, and he decided he was going to have it rebuilt, and he brought it back out, and he sent it to me. We were going to do it, and he bought a bunch of parts for it. His dad passed before the car even got started.
Oh.
So he basically sent us the pink slip and says, you guys drive it around, and we've been holding on to it ever since. So that's why it's stripped down, is I use it for a prototype car, because this car has originally 40,000 original miles on it. So the frame is straight, the chassis is all there. So I fit control arms on it, I fit parts onto it. And when he had the car, he used to race for Excel and or drive for them and work for them. So they did a whole bunch of different wiring and ignition systems on this car. So it was around for a long time, and it was a very cool car. And he wanted to paint it a different color. And I finally talked him out of it. I said, no, let's leave it the cool brown. We'll put some nice looking wheels on it, like a gold colored wheel or something, and leave even the interior and send it.
The Rocket Attacks look good on there,
though.
They sure do. I had those on Cite, and I just love the way that wheel looks.
Yeah, we were just playing with those. That's also a 315, and we're seeing how much we're going to have to move to get it underneath there.
Yeah. This, another 69.
Another 69.
And I'm aware of this, the patina on this. Susie and I have been kind of going back and forth on stuff, and she took a paint education course on how to do authentic patina, and I think
she nailed it.
I think she nailed it.
Yeah. So this is an original drag car from the 70s. That's the original paint. We did have to go in, and you can see even in the 69, they got rid of the line because they had a big drag slick in there.
Mm-hmm.
But they had covered up the gills in here, and it had a big dent, and so the Bondo was about an inch thick, and it was cracking, so we pulled it all out, straightened it out, and filled it all back in, and then, of course, they painted it, and Susie painted it, and patinaed everything, so it still looked old.
Yeah.
So the car had nothing when it came in. It was a drag car. It had no dashboard. It had no radiator support. It had literally nothing. It had 70s. It had a switch on the firewall to turn your fuel on, and then you got in and started the car.
Right. So what's in it now? Obviously the LS engine.
LS3. And we did a full ride tech suspension on this one, front and back. Everything from Holley is on this one.
Yeah.
This one was a crazy fun Holley build.
Holley accessory drive.
Accessory drive from Holley. Their Frostbite, is that
Frostbite,
what
that's what they do.
Their stuff, their cooling system. Yep. Of course, their brakes, because they own Bear Brakes, got ride tech.
Yep.
So it's all their gear. That's a neat one.
It looks great, man. You know what I really like? I like the fact that not everything has to be a slick and shiny paint job. You guys have slick and shiny. You've got great looking cars over here, and it represents the company well. I love the thematic color, the dark blue. I think that's a suspension geek thing, right?
It is.
Yeah.
And it was not by accident, but by accident. Susie had picked this color. She had looked at cars for years at car shows and finally picked the color she wanted. And the reason I ended up painting my car the same color is because we have damaged this car racing it. It's been, bent and beat up, and every repair has been easy because there's no metallic. It's a dark color. It doesn't seem to fade.
Yep.
So I personally don't like blue, but I thought that's the easiest way to be able to repair that car, because we've had, when you mix reds don't match the same.
Well, one of my favorite sayings is that there's always more paint in the can, and when you pick a color that's ridiculously complex, then your touch-ups become a thing. For me, I actually get paranoid of driving them when they're too complicated. And so my little Miata has got, $500 worth of Summit Racing paint on it, and I don't care.
I was going to say, you can bring it over. We got track wrap. We can put some track wrap on there.
I almost brought it over today. Almost. But I wanted air conditioning and Sirius radio. All right, this is kind of the elephant in the room here. Hi, Susie. We're going to talk to Susie in a second, but we've got a Challenger here that has some challenges.
Yes. So, this was also LS swapped. Oh, no, I'm wrong. That is a big SRT supercharged Hemi in that one. Yep.
Okay, and if you looked under the hood of my Miata, you might recognize this.
They use the same coolant overflow?
It's the same coolant overflow.
Oh, man. Yep. Yeah, Mopar.
Because, like you said, there's no room in the Miata, and that one is actually small enough to fit. So this is going to be a very potent car. It's got all the good stuff.
Yeah, it's got aftermarket suspension in it. Yep.
Does it,
Viking coilovers on this one.
Does it run?
Yes.
Okay, so it already runs.
Yep.
But you guys got it, and this is a tale that I've heard many, many, many times. You got it ready for paint.
Yeah, that's exactly what the customer said. Oh, I have this great car. I just want you guys to paint it and start building closeout panels and put the interior in it. It's ready for paint.
Now, I'm not opposed to body filler. Body filler is a tool. It's polyester surface enhancement material. There's nothing wrong with using body filler unless you use it to excess. And Tommy Bosch has taught me the phrase cave and pave, and I'm seeing this right here. This is caved and paved.
And we've straightened it already.
Yeah.
It was actually deeper. You can see where we've gone in with the spot weld and pulled everything dense out.
And I don't want to beat people up that aren't here to defend themselves.
No,
this isn't ready. So, you know, buyer beware, right? You got to be aware of what you're buying or paying for.
It looked straight. It was straight. Yeah, it was fully primered. The problem was that there was a couple little, you could kind of see a couple little cracks in the Bondo. And we were really worried about it. And I said, the painter, John, of course, he says, well, I can't paint over that. I want to make sure there's no rust underneath there.
Of course.
So when he started to gun it and grinding it, it's like, quarter of an inch of Bondo, and then he found rust and was like, oh. Mm-hmm. Then we started going through other spots. Yeah, that's actually a really pretty spot. If you come all the way up here, this was completely filled with Bondo. And it was ready for paint.
Yeah. Yeah. Look at that.
Yeah, that's so the previous shop had fully covered that with Bondo, sculpted it all in, primered it, smoothed it, blocked it, and sent it back. And I mean, okay, I get it if it's old school, but I would really be afraid of a customer, even just a small impact. You're not going to have much roof or strength or support
there.
That's
where it comes in. That's not just a bad repair that you can roll your eyes over. That's an unsafe repair. People don't realize this is a unibody car. There's torsional rigidity attached to these places. There's structural integrity that is tied in to these points in the vehicle. And when they get messed with, and then you throw a freaking 700 horsepower Hemi at it, it gets a little bit sketchy.
Yeah.
So I'm glad it's in your hands because you guys will vet all this stuff out. You'll straighten it out and get the guy back into a position where he's not only going to have a nice looking car, but it's going to be functional and
reliable and comfortable. And at least I know it's going to be safe.
Yeah.
So that's the big thing. We spend in the shop, I bet 30% of the cars we get in here are repairs that have been other places that haven't been done well. I'm not saying that I'm the best. I'm just saying that, you know, I'm getting cars in where they put a whole new suspension in. Perfect example, I had a real pretty Camaro come in and I went to jack it up and the leaf spring fell off the car. And it wasn't because it was a bad install, it's that the leaf spring had rusted and the guy who put lowering blocks on and he put drop spindles and coilovers in the front. Mm-hmm. So he thought he had done everything right, but he needed to keep going.
Yeah.
So there was little things like that we find all the time.
Yeah. I want to talk to Susie about the car that's behind you. Susie, are you?
Good.
Introduce yourself to the awesome people that are watching.
Oh, my name is Susie Bowder. I'm probably not really known as much for myself as I am being the partner of Suspension Geek and for my car.
And you go by Trackside Susie, right?
I go by Trackside Susie.
So on the socials, you can find her. But we're going to go over to your awesome Flair Witch car, and we're going to flip it around. This thing is so badass, if I'm allowed to say that.
You are. I think you are. You're the boss.
What is it?
It's a 1963 Rambler American station wagon. It was the family truckster of the 60s. I like to say that it was kind of the Pinto of the 60s. Everybody had a Rambler in one form or another.
You know, I'm not getting Pinto vibes anymore.
No. I mean Pinto in amount that were sold. This was a $15,000 car.
Mm-hmm.
The same platform was used for a wagon, a four-door wagon, a two-door wagon, a coupe, a convertible coupe. I think that's it. I don't think they had a four-door coupe.
And you guys have obviously done it outfitted like a race car with all the good stuff, right?
Yeah, I tried to keep it as classic as I possibly could because I didn't think it's such an odd duck that I didn't really want to bastardize it too much.
Yeah, yeah.
And I really loved the way that it looked. I mean, that's why I bought it in the first place.
It's such a unique looking car.
Yeah.
And you guys took it 10 steps further and made it race car. So talk to me about the wheel flares.
Those are 8.5-inch wheel flares, and we knew we were going to have to flare the wheels because this car originally came with like 6-inch wide tires on it.
And a narrow track width and all that stuff,
correct.
Right?
Yeah. It is a unibody car, so we were able to work with it really, really pretty easily in that we just grafted a Camaro underneath it.
Yeah.
So that's got a first-gen Camaro front subframe and a fifth-gen Camaro independent rear suspension. And, you know, I tell people that don't start with an odd duck if you think that you're going to save money. Mm-hmm. Because it's sort of the opposite, right? This car cost me $700 plus probably $40,000 or more.
Right.
But I wanted a wagon, and I wanted to race it. So what do? You go to a platform that you know has plenty of aftermarket choices to bolt onto it.
Yep.
Or graft onto it or whatever you want to call it.
And then you have somebody like Rodney that knows how to do all that stuff.
Right, right. Yeah. He did all the measuring. He did all the geometry. And originally, the fender flares were going to be probably in the range of 4 inches. And then we started putting together the rear end. It already had a four link in it. And we basically just started pricing out the rear end.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he started going on eBay and said, listen, let's put IRS in it. We want IRS in it ultimately anyway because mm-hmm. of the wheelbase. And it's going to cost us less money.
Yeah.
And we're just going to weld that cradle in there, and mm-hmm. we're going to be done.
Yeah. So if you want to follow this car, you want to see it online, YouTube, there's all kinds of video on. But the coolest thing is this car, not only with Jay Leno in it, right?
Yeah.
But you guys were in the running to become a Hot Wheels, right?
We were.
So talk to us about that.
That was really crazy. A hot, hot day up in Nashville in a Walmart parking lot with people with strollers and dogs and all these things. And here we are showing our cars for the 50th anniversary of Hot Wheels Legends.
Wow.
And it was the first year they did it. They've since, it was so successful, they've carried it on. But yeah, here I come. They called my name and I was astounded.
Yeah.
So the car went off to SEMA for the second time.
Wow.
Yeah, which,
very cool.
You know, having a home built car go to SEMA at all is just, It's pretty darn
humbling.
Well,
it's a huge honor. I've been humbled and honored. I've had two out there in my whole entire automotive career, and it's an amazing thing. It's scary as heck, and
so
at the
scary.
Same time, it's such an honor to
it
have
is.
That, and it's memories that you'll never forget.
I will not forget. I will not forget the experiences that I had. That's how I met Jay Leno. Hot Wheels mm-hmm. introduced me. I was told that he voted for my car. I didn't in the end win, although I think there still is a chance I might get a Hot Wheels. You know, I'm trying to work some magic behind the scenes, but because I think it's deserving of Hot Wheels personally.
Well, it is. I mean, it's just, you don't miss this car. You see it, you know exactly.
Yeah.
That's Flair Witch for sure.
Yeah.
Pop the hood. We got to look under the hood of this thing.
Sure. She's dirty today. We were racing on Saturday.
Old school hood catch from the outside.
So the one thing that is remarkable about this car is the exterior of the car is 100% original mm-hmm. other than those fender flares.
Yeah.
So all these unique body lines and stuff, that's all the car. We took off the bumper and we took off the rear bumper.
Yeah. And you've got all that throwback, all that style that these cars, these modern cars, are devoid of.
Yeah.
They're aerodynamic jelly beans that have zero character.
Well, and when the car was beige, you know, stock beige, you didn't see any of these lines. You didn't see how the roof actually kind of curves out. It's just, and how it's a wedge. It's crazy. So, yeah. So here's a 6-liter LS. Basically the same build as Rodney's car. We built this one while his was down, and it's been so good to me that he was like, that's just the rate we're going.
Yeah. And super crisp and clean under the hood, everything, all business.
Tidy, not clean.
Well, you know, clean as in organized.
Yeah.
That's what I'm talking about. And that,
it's no spaghetti bowl of wiring.
No, the suspension geek symmetry. Things like this, this stuff matters. This is where you can tell somebody is an experienced car builder. Everything is there for a reason.
Yeah.
There's economy in it. There's no fluff, and everything is functional.
No, it's not a show car. It is a functional race car. you know, as far as autocross racing goes.
Yeah.
So there's lots of cooling opportunities. There's a lot of weight balance.
Serviceable remote oil filter. Yep. That is a nice touch. I have, yeah, for sure. For quick maintenance.
Yep. Yep. And if you notice, there's no air cleaner.
Hmm. Have you got filters in the...
I have cone filters inverted into the intake tubes.
Really?
So that I've got a low plenum intake.
Yeah. So you still get the CFM.
So there are cones that go back to about here.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And what company makes them? Is that a K&N thing?
That is Spectra K&N.
Wow.
And I've had a couple of people say, well, this car isn't driven because it doesn't have an air cleaner. I'm like, well, why don't you ask me where the air cleaner is? Mm-hmm. You know? And then I've had people say, well, that will never work. Well, Spectra designed this.
Yeah.
They designed this system for me because I was in the Spectra booth, the Spectra K&N booth at SEMA. So it works.
Very cool.
100% works.
Very cool. Super
And my cones stay much cleaner than being in an air box, you know, off here on some corner.
Aftermarket radiator, obviously.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a big radiator. Look at
it
that.
It is.
Yeah. Which we need. Lots of air intake. Very cool. So I'm going to go out on a limb and say that there's video that I can rob off YouTube of this car 100%. Running around in circles.
Yeah. So, yeah, steel.
Right.
No carbon fiber, no fiberglass.
Well, it
steel.
It gets your curb weight down low, right?
Right. This is a 50-50 weight balanced car.
Say that again.
This is a 50-50 weight balanced car.
That's,
well, okay, so that's a slight lie. It's like 49-51.
But still,
yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
And it's a relatively short wheelbase.
100 inches.
So 100 inches, my Miata is 96. Mm-hmm. When this thing gets crazy on you, does it want to swap ends?
No, because it's 100-inch wheelbase and it's 80 inches wide.
Ah,
and
yeah,
it's 49-51 weight balance.
Yeah.
And all my weight is sprung.
Yeah.
So I run big springs, big shocks.
Yeah.
I'm like a snake in the grass.
Yeah.
And that's part of that IRS too.
Yeah. Let's talk about the thing. And what I mean is it's a male-dominated hobby. It's a male-dominated industry. It's
it
a male-dominated workforce. And
yes.
And you're a credible person. Never mind.
I try to be.
Yeah,
I don't know it all, but
sure.
I'm certainly not
well,
going to
no, and no
pretend
dude
like I do.
Knows it all either. But you've got a little bit more of an uphill battle gaining legitimacy and gaining people's respect. So talk to me a little bit about maybe some eye roll moments that you've had in people that don't believe that you built this car or that you can actually drive it. Because let me tell you what, the next autocross we're at together, you're going to give me some driving tips because I need some help here. So.
Well, it is an uphill battle. It probably shouldn't be. When it comes to racing, it really shouldn't be because the way that women think is very linear. We're problem solvers. We think about if I do this, this is going to happen. And that's very conducive to racing. I can't even explain how conducive it is.
Yeah.
Also thinking on your feet.
Yeah.
So women are never last. I've never been to a race where there was a woman in last place.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not to say that men are not, but they tend to drive with their throttle.
Yeah. But you were just saying something about Jay Leno.
I was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I want to quote my friend Mary Posey, who always said, the car doesn't know whether you have ovaries or testicles. She did not say it quite that.
She's got another
cleanly.
One. It goes something like, stick you bitch.
Yes,
something
she
like
does.
That, right.
She
yeah.
does. And as a matter of fact, I have a stick you witch sticker that I need to put back on the car.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah. So with Leno, of course, Leno's a car nerd.
Yes.
He truly is a car nerd.
Oh, my gosh, absolutely.
For anybody who thinks he, you know, is all fluff and no matter, that is not the case. He is hands-on. He is a nerd. He ran me through the paces on this car.
Yeah.
He asked me some of the most random questions with intent of knowing why we made those decisions.
Yeah.
And I'm, you know, I'll first and foremost say, I did not build this car by myself.
Right.
Rodney was probably 60% of it. I tend to do the tedious work, the wiring, and the things that people don't have patience for.
Right.
But I did, I welded and I installed drive shafts and things like that. So I've had my hands on every inch of the car. And he was putting me through my paces.
So he's qualifying you. He's testing
was.
You. Yeah.
He was.
Yeah, yeah.
He did not, you know, he just didn't he didn't pull any punch. I mean, he didn't pull punches, but he didn't give me any breaks. Yeah. That's for sure. So we're coming off the track. We were probably on the track for about an hour, going around in circles.
And with him riding with you?
No, he was driving.
Oh, okay. Got you. Yeah.
Yeah, he had to drive. His people said, no riding. Mm. And I'm guessing that had maybe
probably
insurance.
For safety insurance kind of thing. Yeah.
But
yeah.
He kept saying, but I want her to drive. I want to ride. So anyway, we were coming off the track and he said, hey, is your husband here? And I said, yeah. He goes, well, where is he? And I said, he's over there. And he was kind of off in the corner. Mm-hmm. And watching it all go by and using his phone to film every second that he could.
Of course.
And he said, well, you want to put him on camera? And I said, do you want to put him on camera? I don't know. I don't care. And I will say this about Rodney. Rodney is, he pushed me out front. Mm-hmm. He wanted this to be my deal, my project. He already was getting a lot of attention for his project.
Right.
You know, and kudos to him for being that humble. And I said, I don't know. Do you want to? And he said, well, Susie, we've spent an afternoon together and it's clear you know every inch of this vehicle. It is clear you have had your hands on this car. The minute I put your husband on this camera, all of your credibility goes out the window. Mm-hmm. They will all say, oh, he just built a car for his wife.
Yep.
And I said, thank you. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was a little starstruck to say the least anyway.
Yeah.
And I just said, you know, that's really insightful of you.
Well, and very generous of him too.
Very generous.
So that's very cool. Yeah. I got to meet Jay once out at SEMA, and I was absolutely starstruck, and so much respect for him because he literally does this stuff, and he gets his hands dirty, and it's an amazing car. Just so you guys know, this is not going to be the last time that we're doing a shop tour with these guys. We're going to see this next vehicle in different stages of build.
Yeah.
And we're going to find you guys at SEMA, me and Eddie and Jason with AMD Garage. We're going to come and scope you out. And if this thing's running and driving and going around in circles really fast with lots of tire smoke, you owe me a ride.
You got it.
All right. So we're going to check out something amazing. All right, my friend, take me around this truck. What do we got?
So it's actually, I think it's a 72 C10. And we're putting an earlier grill on it. Want to make it look more like a 67, so I got a 67 grill on it. We're going to put a 67 hood on there.
So already, it looks shorter and lower. So talk to me about the chassis.
That's stock height. That's how they came in 1967.
Sure it is. Yeah.
We're actually using the stock chassis. We're going to reinforce it. What we did in the front is we used the Detroit Speed front bikini clip that they make. It's based on the Corvette suspension. We got rid of the radiator support. We're doing the same thing as we did in the other car, but we're actually not going to put the radiator here. We're going to put coolers on both sides. You can see we have a balance bar kit for the brakes. That's from Rob up there at No Limit Racing. We're using a Howe, I don't know what you call it, steering quickener from Howe Racing, the circle track guys. So
explain to me what that does, because I have no idea. Does that change the ratio?
Yeah, so a regular rack is a 12-1.
Yeah.
And for autocross, over the last few years, 12-1's always been fantastic, but what we're seeing is the courses are much quicker now and tighter, so we're reducing it. You know, 12-1 is 2.5 turns lock to lock. With the quickener on there, we've reduced it down to a 1.5 ratio. So you have it's basically a 90 and then back to a 90 for lock to lock.
Wow.
So it's you know, instead of a 12-1, now it's a 5-1 ratio.
Yeah. And so the backside of this suspension is gorgeous.
The DSC
stuff is
billet hubs. Yep.
Yeah, and it's all based off Corvette geometry. You said?
Yep.
Super nice. Is it a generic rack or is it a GM rack?
No, it's made just for the C10, and then we used a Viking triple adjustable coilovers on it to get our ride height down. This one also is going to have 315s in it. That's a new rocket wheel on there, and it's got those are 18x11s with a 5-inch backspace. In case anybody wants to know, so they can pretend they can do the same thing.
Such a great look.
Yeah.
All right. And obviously.
Yeah, we gutted the inside. We haven't started too much. We started putting a halo in, a bar. We're going to have bars going through the front. We put a harness bar in the back. Yep.
Yeah, because you got to, as much as you want to reinforce, you know, this cab is a big cube, so it's not really going to flex, but the chassis underneath it.
Yeah.
So your suspension, your reinforcement is tied into the chassis, right?
Yes. Yep. And man, we have I have a cross brace that we're building for the center of the truck too.
Yeah.
I'll drag that up if you want to take a look at it. And then we brought the bars through so there's less chassis flex, and then we've attached it. Everything's just kind of rough set in there. So we attached it to the rear end, or the back of the chassis, as you can see.
And what assembly is this?
That's a 2015 Camaro IRS. And it literally, I mean, it's like the GM engineers looked at their old truck and said, we can make that fit. And the reason I say that is you can see, if you've ever worked on the old truck, this was your bump stop for your actual axle.
Yeah.
And your axle was back here. That bump stop and the one on the other side line up directly with the fifth gen Camaro cradle bracket.
Isn't that cool?
I mean, I just ran the bolt straight down the center. That's it. And we're like, I mean, we're going to do reinforcement work, but
yeah,
for mock-up, you couldn't get any more straight.
That's kismet. That's really cool. I've heard that the guys that are doing the P71, the Crown Vic swap, they're finding that the cab mounts are almost in the right place too. So who knew if the Ford engineers knew that? But I mean, this is really cool. So is this 2010 and up Zeta chassis is what it is,
yeah,
but
yep.
The GM assemblies, if somebody's looking to do this with big V8 power, what vehicle do they want to reach for? Is it a V8 car?
This is the V8 car? One, yep. And we did this has got the 273 rear gear. And the reason we like that one is that most of the 273s are posi already. So now it's one more thing you don't have to worry about buying or upgrading on your stick axle.
Well, I learned this the hard way, but also if you're going to boost, especially with turbo, a shorter gear set, a lower numerical number is more boost friendly because it builds pressure down low in the RPM instead of spinning things loose. I made that mistake with Cetane.
Oh, okay.
Big turbo on that thing, and I had 370
tall gears.
Yeah, 370 gear, and it wanted more time to spool. So, I mean, that's a really great choice if you're going to do forced induction also, I think.
Yeah.
So are you going to keep the frame C-channel? And what I mean by C-channel, folks, if you don't know, is this right here is hollow. It's a C-channel. It's shaped like a C. It goes all the way down the frame rail. And my gut, and the reason I'm asking Rodney this, is my gut is I'm going to box that frame in if I'm using the original one. But talk to me about that.
So, yeah, we're boxing the frame all the way in from the front to the back. And we're getting rid of that center cross member. And this is actually a cross member we're putting in there. So once we box the frame in, this will go in. The drive shaft will run through the center. That'll work as a drive shaft safety loop.
Yeah, that looks like something out of the Transformers movie, but but it looks super strong at the same time. Did you make this?
No, it's a pre-bought unit.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and so, but we're boxing it. Pre-built unit just comes with a bracket you're supposed to bolt in, but we're not bolting anything to the chassis. And then we'll end up, since we moved everything forward and shortened the trucks are usually 112 inches long, or 118, sorry. We're 104, which is the same length as a Blazer.
Yeah.
So we end up chopping off almost 12 inches of rear end here.
Very
cool. Of rear frame.
Well, it gives it a race car-y look, right?
So we cut down the yep.
That looks amazing.
Well, what we'll end up doing is, this was just for mock-up because it's the old panels. So I'm actually going to build an aluminum spacer and bring it back so you still have your cab gap. So when you first see the truck, it won't look like a unibody. It'll still have a cab gap and you're going to, why does that truck look so strange?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool. Well, and now with the giant AMD pile over there, you don't have to worry about these crusty bed sides, right?
No, I know.
That's very good.
Yeah, so it was really good for mock-up. Well, that one's going to be tough. We've got new AMD door handles, too.
They'll be in. Not just sheet metal. More than just metal. So you're going to keep the character of the original dash?
Yes. Yep. But it's going to have a digital in front of it. We're not going to change anything really on the dash.
Right.
I have the original gauges. I was trying to talk them into letting us use original gauges, but we'll probably just build a billet panel in front of it and then drop a digital gauge right in the center.
Right, like
and
a then we'll have pack a, or something.
Yep, and then we'll have a fuel gauge and, of course, an extra oil pressure off to the side,
right.
Things that are super vital.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was kind of cool because I thought, man, that's some really cool old school gauges. I want to keep them.
So I know a guy that makes a housing for those Holley gauge packs, I think for this truck. I'll connect you with him. He goes by Car Chains 3D, Corey is his name, but he made the, if you've seen the
Miata.
He
made it for C-Thing?
Pardon me?
Did he make one for C-Thing?
No, I did that out of that. I body worked it up. But he did the one out of the Miata, and it bolts in from the back. So it's the Holley 6.86 dash, and because that car was tiny in the dash anyways. So he prototyped it for me, and now all the spec Miata guys have that. So, but yeah, Corey's a talented guy, and I'll connect you to if you want to. So what engine is going in this giant hole?
So the owner, Casey, actually has two other cars he races. He races a C5, a Z06, and a fifth-gen Camaro. Mm-hmm. And the original motor in that Z06 had blown up, so he replaced it with a 7-liter dry-sumped it. So that original motor went and got rebuilt, so he's got aluminum 6.2, I think is what came in those Corvettes, or 6.3.
Yeah.
And that's what's going back in here, and they beefed that one up too. So
what Rodney's not telling you is that none of this stuff that he does, oh, let's just put an IRS out of a 2010 Camaro, 2017 Camaro, whatever it is, in this C10 truck. And we'll put this aluminum 6.2. We're going to shave some wheelbase off of this thing. None of this stuff is accidental. You've cut your teeth in not only building but racing cars with top shelf companies that are world renowned and world respected. And I just got to say hats off to you, man. What I know, and I'm not just trying to blow smoke because I'm standing here with you and we go back a long way and we're friends, but when you say something, I know that you've thought it through. You've done the thing, you've done the work, you've made the mistakes to earn the authority. And so, I mean, when I see something like this, I'm super excited about it. I know you're not guessing at it. I know you're coming at it with some knowledge behind you. So how do people find Rodney Prouty? How do people find Suspension Geek?
Just look up suspensiongeek.com.
That was the right answer.
I mean, it's pretty, we're on Facebook, on... I don't know, are we on TikTok or Instagram or any of those also, I think?
Instagram.
Yeah, and then, of course, our own website. And then on there, there's a bunch of pages on there. It's not just parts. There's pages on there that talk to you about suspension and how it works together. We talk about alignments, how it's important. I mean, there's a bunch of stuff in there, and I try and add stuff all the time.
Yeah.
And, in fact, one of the things we talked about is we have a new website that will be out this year sometime, and it'll have a whole blog or update post section, so we'll have hundreds of pages of information for people then. So that's really the emphasis behind it all. To me, it was when those companies I worked for, it was all about giving people information. It's key.
Well, the first time that we ever knew each other was on the radar was when I was probably asking for information from Ride Tech. We had some installations to do on the truck show, and you were one of the people that your name kept popping up, and you were excellent tech support for us.
I traveled all over the country for them doing that. I mean, they sent me to, they'd call me and go, oh, you got to go to Florida. I'd be in Florida working. Oh, you got to go to Texas. I'd leave there and drive straight to Texas. Yep. Oh, you need to be here in Oklahoma. I'd go to the next shop in Oklahoma.
Yep.
And I literally spent time going from shop to shop and walk in and like, we can't get this cradle to fit. We can't do this. And it's like, here, let me show you the backwoods way to do it.
From concept to this date, what's the time frame that's in this vehicle?
Oh, this only started in late January.
All right.
So we got maybe 8 weeks into it.
How much time is it going to take to get it to SEMA ready?
If I really got on it, 30 days. If I don't get on it, it'll be 35 days.
The truth is, there's probably still going to be tire smoke and overspray smoking out of the door jams when you're pulling it onto the truck to go to SEMA, right?
It's going to be done before then.
Yeah.
I think we want to roll it to, I think, LS Fest before that. So it'll be painted pretty racing and hard before LS Fest. We'll roll it to LS Fest. We hope to win there really big. We've already made an idea of going for the grand champion.
Yeah.
We're going to see. Yeah. And it'll be fun to do it in a truck. Guys with Corvettes keep doing it. I have a great guy that races for us that he's going to be trying to do it also. I think he finished second or third last year, and we updated his Corvette.
Yeah.
So it'll be a tough battle between these two, and it'll be fun.
I can't wait to see more of this truck.
Yeah, so it's 104 inches long. It's 315 square. It's going to have 600 or 700 horsepower, and it's going to have a very old school race car truck to it. So we hope to beat up the Corvettes with a truck.
The only thing missing is a ginormous margarita, right?
Right. No kidding.
But I wanted to talk to you guys about Suspension Geek. You're here in Lawrenceburg, Tennessee, and you have drive-up service and things like that, but people can find the company online, right?
Yep. And we're on Facebook, like we talked about before. Of course, our website. I always enjoy having people come by. It's kind of fun to have people come in the shop.
They get to see that we're actually real people.
Yeah.
We don't just live on the internet.
Yeah, for sure. Well, these days, and it's fine. And it's fine if you do this. There are so many companies that just set up a website and they do it online because they don't like people. They just want to sell parts.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things, that's one of the reasons I wanted to come down and talk to you.
They want to sell parts out of their home garage.
Well, for sure. And drop ship from a different destination.
Yeah.
But you guys, I see you at events, you know, we're friends and all that type of stuff. But you actually enjoy the customer service outreach. And I think that's a huge benefit because people can actually have a conversation with you. Not only are you an authority with the parts and stuff that you sell, but you can offer a little bit of advice and stuff like that. So it's a great thing to have you guys as a resource to people watching.
Yeah, it's one thing to, you know, ask in a Facebook group, hey, what's the best suspension? Well, everybody's gonna tell you what they have.
Well, that's like somebody asking me, what's the best paint to put on my car?
I don't know. Where I don't
do
know your
start?
Car.
Yeah. What are your goals?
Yeah.
What's your budget?
That's exactly it.
All that type of stuff.
Yeah. And you're only going to get so much advice from people who have only installed one or two products.
Yeah.
You know, we're in a room full of different types of builds, different outcomes expected. Mm-hmm. And
I've been lucky enough to work for some pretty good companies and race some really good suspensions.
Yeah.
And that's how I lean the way I do. Our early days were, you know, like everybody else, my very first one, well, first muscle car was Leaf Springs and KYBs.
Yeah.
So everything from there to, you know, like the latest monsters were running triple adjustable coilovers and torque arms. Quadruple adjustable shocks, yeah.
Yeah.
High speed, low speed rebound, high speed, low speed compression.
Yeah, try learning that.
Yeah, it's easy.
And how do you dial that in on the internet, right? You need a Rodney.
Well, and it's funny that you say that because that's one of the things that I get visits from Ridetech and some of the other big companies. And as you see, we're a small shop. You know, we're only, 5,000 square foot.
Yeah.
And
right.
It's just a couple of us, you know, me and her and John, the painter. And Ridetech visits us regularly. And they've told us last year, we're the only guy they know that not only sells all their parts, but installs the parts and races the parts out of all their dealers.
Right.
And I said, really? And he said, yeah. I mean, they had to come down just because they were like, we can't believe that we see you everywhere. And I'm like, we try.
Yeah. Well, I think it's a pretty awesome calling card that you drive what you built.
We do.
And you drive the heck out of what you built.
Yeah.
We do.
Yeah.
So, I'm excited. And if you guys don't know this, I had an issue that I couldn't diagnose by myself. And I had a couple friends come over. Rodney was one of them, Chris Slee from Kiwi Classics and Customs in the Miata. We figured out a drivetrain issue, and now that car is running strong.
It's just because you broke it.
Well, I know. but it's cool to have you in my contacts file with people that know what it is that they're talking about.
It's awesome in Middle Tennessee how many car people we have.
You know, I talked about that on my intro going, man, in this small condensed area, Middle Tennessee, there's a lot of tracks.
I think within 50 miles, how many big builders or relative builders
absolutely
we have?
Absolutely, just south of us,
industry.
Greening Auto,
Goolsby
Customs.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Yeah, Jason Graham is close too, right?
Mm-hmm.
And TriWorks up in Nashville, TC Panic, Bay One Customs in Springfield. Yeah, there's so many builders.
Yeah.
Will Posey, Big Oak.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he's a buddy of mine that I've known for.
We're gonna go and see Will, and we're gonna drive the Miata too.
Do it on a weekend that we can go to Grip.
Absolutely. Yeah. Tell me about that. What resource is Grip?
Oh gosh. You know,
she's more involved than Grip.
Grip Autocross takes us back to the old days of autocross when it was fun. And I'm not saying that current autocross isn't fun.
It's still fun.
I mean, autocross is fun in general.
Yeah.
But you could be racing alongside a school teacher in a Toyota Yaris.
That's what we have.
Whose hubcaps fall off, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, and kids, younger people, it's a run what you run kind of thing,
mm-hmm.
as well as you'll get SCCA champions. You'll get folks like us that show up with, you know, Uzis. But what we don't, it's, we're not about winning.
Yeah, I'm not there to win. I'm literally there to have fun.
Yeah.
We even sponsor it. We because everything that they take in, they're giving it away.
So on top of all that, it's nonprofit.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you get a day full of autocross runs. You're probably going to get 6, 8, who knows how many runs. Mm-hmm. All the money, they combine the money and they give it to a trade show, a trade school scholarship.
Yeah, that's great.
And it's a trades within our industry.
Yeah, so
yeah, automotive trades.
They have a guy last year that won it, and he's doing body and paint.
Yeah.
Which is really cool. And I think the year before was also a young guy that, in one of the trade schools down there. He's a mechanic.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. So it's neat.
That's near and dear to where I'm hardwired. You know,
this,
if we don't take the responsibility to give back, then nobody will.
So. Well, and we have to pass it on.
We have to pass it on. And what better way to pass it on than having an event that's just there for the pure joy of it.
Oh, exactly.
Take the competition out of it. I don't care how many points I get. Let me, and ultimately it comes down to really, if you're competing, you're competing against yourself anyways. It's not multiple cars on a run. You're competing against the clock.
Who else is driving an LS swapped Rambler? What I mean? And who's, pushing 60 old lady.
Yeah.
You can't really compete unless it's a like for like driver vehicle course.
Yeah, she won a couple of those last year and she doesn't take it. She just says, nope, give it to the next person because it's like she said, it's not a fair fight when you're bringing Uzi. You know, I show up with that thing and the War Machine comes out and it's just, it's like, nope. Give it to the guy with the 300Z because he came out here to have fun.
They asked
me if I'm going to run ladies class every weekend that we go down there. I'm like, no, that would be
got
a
something
no.
in my eye. So
I look around at the Yaris.
I can't quote Mary, but that's what Mary talked about. Mm-hmm. The car doesn't know if you have a.
I already said that.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, yeah, you were there. So with this tight time frame, and it is a tight time frame that you've got this C10 going out to SEMA, and you said it's going to be vetted out and pretty and running hard before then. Yeah. What does it mean to have a company like AMD want to help out, see the passion, and understand that? It's not just about some sponsored parts. It's about the right parts that are going to save you time and money. I know that helps you.
Oh, tremendous.
Tremendous.
The amount of, you see the car. The amount of rough work that's on there is amazing. But to be able to put a quality steel on there that we're not going to have to run a skim coat all the way down the side of the bed.
Yeah, for sure.
To get rid of all the dimples of...
There's nothing wrong with filler. There's nothing wrong with bodyworking a vehicle. But... when the goal of the project is within like a 3 or 4 month time period, to me, that's when the investment in a high quality part comes in and it pays you back. It literally buys your time back.
Well, there's that, yeah. And there's also the notion that the customer knows exactly what they're getting.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You don't end up with it's ready for paint.
Yeah.
Like the Mopar where everything's just covered over.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, they know exactly what they're getting. They know exactly, but the recognition of AMD to want to work with us, we still consider ourselves a little guy in Tennessee.
That's pretty cool.
And, we're just, five steps away from our home garage where we built the other two cars that have now kind of put us on the map. So working with companies like AMD who recognize what an impact that's going to make on our business as well as for our customer, that's just... Yeah.
So you just referred to your company as we're the little guys, and... I think that's a badge of honor, and it's better to be a little guy and a good guy than a big guy that lets people slip through the cracks. So I just want to say thank you guys for being that.
You know? It doesn't always feel that way.
Well, no, but you're driven to keep on doing and keep on doing what it is that you're doing here.
We dove in head first. We have no choice.
Yeah.
We're going to have to swim.
Very cool. So let's say again, where do people find you online? Have you got a YouTube channel?
We have a YouTube channel, Suspension Geek. Is it Suspension Geek or is it Rodney Prouty?
No, it's Suspension Geek.
Okay, Suspension Geek. We are suspensiongeek.com for parts and information. Mm-hmm. You can always call us at the shop. Our phone number is on our Facebook page, which is also Suspension Geek. I'm Trackside Susie.
Mm-hmm. I think the Suspension Geek page also has some of the YouTube videos up there. So if you can't, if you're like me and YouTube illiterate and you can't find YouTube or anything on it, just click on those. It takes you to YouTube.
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh, look where I am. And then just go ahead and like whatever you like there.
And Instagram also?
Instagram also, Suspension Geek.
Yeah. Very cool. Thank you guys for showing me around.
Thank you.
And it's great to see you again. And I get inspired when I come down here. So for me, I get so bogged down into the minutiae of my own world. I've got a bunch of hats that I wear, but this allows me to see some fresh air. Today we get to see some sunshine.
Yeah.
And I get to see some incredible builds on the way. So you're welcome.
Bye.
Awesome. I thought you'd be inspired to clean up around here.
Nope, I'm out. See ya. I am so inspired by what we just saw. Rodney and Susie are the real deal. They're super nice folks, but credible and really, really qualified builders. So I'm super excited to see what they've got kicking out of their shop, and hopefully we'll get some autocross time together later on this season. And when we go out to SEMA with AMD Garage, we're going to bring you guys with us and get some seat time in that bad to the bone truck. So in the meantime, I'm going to head back to my domicile. It's getting close to time to hydrate, and I will see you guys on the next AMD Garage episode. Also, don't forget, come and see us at events. You can go to the Autometal Direct website or find us on the socials and see where we're going to pop up. Come and say hi. We've always got stuff going on at the sites, at the car shows. There's always a booth, and there's the Eddie Bear Foundation. Bring a bear for the Fill the Fair Lane campaign, and I just can't wait. I'm looking forward to seeing you guys soon. Take care.